Hello, my name is Tobias Lilja. I was the audio director on Little Nightmares 2. I'm going to talk about the audio in the game a little bit. To me, the audio of Little Nightmares is a lot about just trying to enhancing this kind of nightmare world where you as a kid are running bare feet on concrete, being hunted by this grotesque enemies breathing down your neck. And the audio is all about just trying to enhance that and kind of tap into this surreal, nightmarish vibe. But to do that, I think it's also important with realism. Like, a lot of the sounds are pretty realistic. Like, if you pick up a tin can and throw it, it will sound as you would expect. But then there's also this surreal layer, maybe mostly from the music. And of course, the place itself is pretty surreal and otherworldly, with these enemies and everything that's going on. Also, another thing that really affects, I guess, everything in the game is the fact that we don't have any dialogue in the game. It makes it more complicated for everyone, but also, because you have to, all the information that you will get through text or dialogue has to be told in some other way, even if it's through the environment or through animations or audio. It has to be told in some other way, and it is also interesting because you as a player have to kind of be a bit more invested into kind of trying to interpret the world and the environment and trying to figure out what's going on without someone telling you what's going on. Just because there are no spoken words doesn't mean that there aren't any voices in the game. The vocal sounds are actually really important sounds. Like, all the enemies have a voice, maybe a breathing sound. And so when they get maybe the player makes a sound that alerts them, they usually do like a scream and then start to chase. And so that kind of vocal sounds are really important to kind of understand what these creatures are, and also maybe understand the intent. Are they chasing you, or what are they up to? Do I need to hide? You know, so. And also the player, the Mono and Six, but also has, of course, vocal sounds. They do these effort sounds when they interact with stuff, and they cannot even say, like, we have this call feature where the Mono can kind of hello call to Six. And so even though there isn't any kind of spoken words, there are still a lot of voices in the game, and that's important to kind of add a presence and add some human like the player in Six becomes more human if they have a voice. The fact that there is no spoken words also kind of enhances the nightmarish vibe a little bit. To me, it also enhances the feel of not really belonging there. And another thing that we wanted to do in the sequel was to give each level in the game a unique sound style somehow, because the environments are so different. We also wanted the sound to be different. So for example, in the first level, you're in this forest with a wooden cabin where the hunter lives, and with his taxidermied family. So we started by just looking at the environment, looking at concept art and the different places you would be, and trying to kind of find things in the environment that could help us. There is a swamp in the wilderness, and a swarm of flies does this, you know, this droning bass sound, like, and that could work as a kind of a bass element, almost a musical element. I really liked when we find sounds like that that exists naturally in the environment, but they can also kind of work in a more musical context, because we can kind of blend them into the soundtrack instead of just having this obvious, you know, layer of music on top of everything. We can kind of use sounds from the environment and kind of sneak them into to being a kind of a music layer. And I really like that when the like sound effects and ambiences and music kind of blend together, it becomes a blurred line. It's difficult to maybe tell what's music and what's ambience and what's in the game world and what's not. And that's something I always look for in the environments, elements like that. But if we look at another level, like school, for example, that's a totally different story. We have the bully characters, these little rascals running around building traps, and then the teacher character, she's playing the piano, and so it's a totally different environment that needed different sound elements to kind of build suspense and build the soundscape. One of my favorite scenes in the game is probably when the teacher is playing the piano. It's near the end of the school level, and she sits by the piano by herself and plays a piece, and the piece she choose to play says something about her as a character. Like, she has picked this piece to play by herself. It says something about her, but it also becomes a piece of music because you can hear the piano in the level. And you as a player also, when she does pauses to write something in her notes, you as a player also have to stay quiet, otherwise she will hear you and attack you. So it also becomes kind of integrated in the gameplay. The piano kind of exists in all these levels at the same time. It's both gameplay, it's music, and it also says something about the teacher character. And I really like that kind of when a single element that actually exists in the world can work in so many levels. If we compare the first game with the second game, I think that from an audio perspective, I think we really wanted to emphasize the kind of claustrophobic submarine vibe in the first game, because most of the first game takes place underwater, and it's pretty easy to kind of add these heavy, thick, droning industrial tones. Just to add this kind of, it makes sense when you're underwater, right? but in the second game we couldn't really do that. It's more open spaces and even outdoor spaces, but of course there are claustrophobic spaces as well in the sequel, but we couldn't really always rely on that kind of claustrophobic kind of oppressive sound. The second game sounds a little bit different. There are maybe more background music, and like in the Pale City level near the end, there's a lot of like heavy rainfall, which is a cool sound element. And it's also a wider range of emotions generally in the second game. We have the relationship between Mono and Six, so there's maybe more warmth and friendship, which didn't really, those type of emotions didn't really exist in the first game at all. So, I mean, it's still a pretty dark and grim world, but there are definitely some spots of light coming through. As a final note, I'd like to mention some new technical feature in the sequel, and we knew already from the get-go that we wanted some kind of occlusion system. It means basically how let's say a sound is playing from a nearby room, but the sound gets filtered through the wall. So we wanted to do that in real time, and so we built a tool where we could specify how or define how sounds would sound like when they were playing from nearby rooms. An example from the game is in the school level, where the teacher is spanking something, probably a poor bully character, and the sound is going through this ventilation shaft, and the player is standing on the other side of the ventilation shaft, so the sound is getting filtered by the ventilation shaft. So there is a, you know, this kind of canned metallic reverberation effect added onto the kind of slap sound. And the closer you get to the teacher, you progress through the ventilation shaft, the more kind of neutral or dry the sound gets. And that's all done in real time. And I think it works really well. It's used in different ways in the entire game. Another example where it's really apparent is in the Pale City level, where we have TVs spread out in the level, and they are all tuned to this kind of psychedelic TV show. You can hear the audio like coming from apartments where you that are off screen, or apartments that you can't even access. And I think it also adds to the feeling of not really belonging there. You're not invited to the party. It's this neighbor next door having a party effect where you just hear the kind of a muffled bass frequencies. And yeah, I think that's an interesting effect. I think that's it for me. Thanks a lot. Bye.